Here's one of those stories. People say, well, I can't believe that. Like a fella told me, and I told you this before, and I'll mention again, said, I'd believe the Bible if it wasn't for those miracles. He doesn't understand, does he? The miracles were so that we would believe. Who would believe Jesus was the Son of God if he didn't do any miracles? Well, you would expect that out of the one claiming to be the Son of God. I tell you, people today come up and say, I got the Holy Spirit, I can do miracles. They can't do what Jesus did. They can't walk on water. The miracles demonstrate that he is the Christ. We use that expression sometime. Man, he could walk on water. What are we talking about? I've heard it used in regard to football coaches that win a tough game. They said, man, he could just walk on water. Like, he can do anything. Sort of like the way we use spread. They just hung the moon. Well, they didn't actually do it, you know, but they think, anybody can hang the moon, I'll be able to do anything, couldn't they? That's why Jesus walked on water. He shows us he can do anything. It's really a tremendous story. What do you think of when you think of Jesus walking on the water? Now, I've seen Mountain Lake so still, so peaceful. It just looked like a sheet of glass. And you might think, I could just walk right across that. Can't do it, but it just might have that appearance. Jesus walked on water in the midst of a storm. It's like another story, and we've already had this story. After a long day of teaching and preaching and healing, and Jesus was tired, and he got in the boat and told his apostles, just take me away across the Sea of Galilee. And he went to sleep in the boat. And while he was asleep, a great storm arose. And the apostles were scared. Now, these are fishermen. They know about handling boats on the sea, but it frightened them. And they woke him and said, carest thou not that we perish? And that frail, worn out, exhausted man stood in that boat and said, peace be still. And all was calm. He looked like God then, didn't he? This is a different story. He's not with his disciples this time. This time, there's similarities. He doesn't say, peace be still, but as soon as he steps in the boat, all goes calm. And he comes to his disciples. They're alone in the midst of this storm, struggling against it. And he comes to them. It's obviously a different event. Similar, but different as well. And the story is told, you see here, it's told by Mark. What Mark is doing here, he's documenting how that story was being told. He heard that story. He heard people talking about it. And so he wrote down what they were saying. But now we also have this given to us by Matthew and by John. And they were there. Two first-hand account documents, and then Mark saying, okay, here's how they tell the story right here. Here's what it is. That is good collaborative evidence on what took place here. And we're going to focus in on what Mark said. Matthew does tell us something interesting here about Peter, and here's where it tells about it. When Jesus came near the ship, Peter said, Lord, if it's you, let me come to you. And Jesus says, well, come on. And Peter walked on the water. He got out of the boat and he started walking on the water. And then he saw the storm and the waves and he began to sink. And he said, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus grabbed Peter, helped him get in the boat, and saved him. Now, Mark doesn't tell us about that part. John doesn't mention that either. And we're going to focus in on what Mark says. There's some real lessons to learn there, though, in that. And people criticize Peter. Why, he shouldn't have taken his eyes off Jesus. But I'm sitting here thinking, you know, he was the only one that was in the boat. The rest of them peeking over the edge of the boat. And Peter actually got out and walked on the water toward Christ. And another thing that I like about Peter is when he got in trouble, he knew who to call for help, didn't he? So while there are some things to criticize with Peter, and Jesus did criticize him for his lack of faith, there's also some things to commend. But that's not going to be the focus in this lesson. We're going to focus on what Mark says. And straightway he constrained his disciples to get in a ship and go to the other side before Bethsaida while he sent away the people. I want you to remember the last time we were in the book of Mark, he had fed 5,000 men with a few loaves and fishes. And that is told by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Well, there would have been 5,000 men telling this story, and so it's recorded four times. And they may have been out there. If John said they would have taken him by force to make him king. And they may have thought he's going to raise a rebellion against Rome in the wilderness the way the Maccabees did. But Luke tells us he taught them about the kingdom. And that's not the kind of kingdom Jesus came to establish. It would be a spiritual kingdom. And so he sends them away fed. He sends his apostles, you need to just leave. Go on across the sea. I'll see you later. And they take off across the sea. But then Jesus, when he sent them away, departed into a mountain to pray. And look at verse 47. And when even was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. I want you to look at that contrast. We're going to see in the next verse what's going on. They're toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary to them. They're out there in the sea in the midst of a storm and fighting against the elements. Those 12 disciples that he's called apostles now, they're out there doing that. Jesus is in the mountains alone with his Father in prayer. The turmoil out in the sea, the peace that is there in the mountains. And then it says in verse 48, he saw them. He saw them. Now I want you to know it's at night and there's a storm and they're several miles out, and yet from the mountains he could look out over the sea and he could see them. I bet those disciples thought they're out of sight of Jesus. He has no idea what's going on out here. He's way off somewhere in those mountains, but Jesus saw them. That itself had to be miraculous, that he could even see what they were doing and even identify them on the sea. But just let this remind you that when you're going through your storms and you're toiling against your trials, Jesus can see it. You may think he doesn't know. Nobody knows the trouble I'm seeing, but Jesus does. He'll see. He'll come to you. He'll be there to help you. That's just one of the comforts we get from this. They were toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary to them, and about the fourth watch of the night. Now you divide the night into four pieces. Jesus had been spending nearly all night then in prayer with his Father. And this is between 3 a.m. and sunrise. That's the fourth watch of the night. So we might call it then the very wee hours of the morning. You've probably gotten up at that time before and couldn't get back to sleep. I've done that sometime. And when you do, think about this story. Jesus, in those very early hours and quiet time in the morning, he'd been praying with his Father. And that's when this takes place. He cometh to them walking upon the sea. And it looks like he's not going to draw too much attention. He's walking like he's going to walk right on by. Just walk right on by. And I'm not sure we grasp the significance of that. But look at verse 49. When they saw him walking on the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit and cried out. For they all saw him and were troubled. Now, I'd have probably cried out myself. That word for spirit here is not the word, it's only used twice in the New Testament. Now, we read about spiritual things all through the New Testament, the Holy Spirit and our spirit, but that's not this word. This word is only used twice, and both times and associated with this event, Matthew and Mark. And the Greek word sounds like our English word phantom. The Greek word sounds like that. And I wouldn't have translated the spirit. What they thought they saw, they thought they saw a ghost. And you can imagine, I mean, now, I don't believe in ghosts. I do not believe in ghosts. But I've had the willies before when I've been out in the cemetery at night, you know. I've wondered, what is that I saw? And it just, and when you're in a troubled situation like that, like they were out on that sea and they're rowing, and then they see something totally unexpected. And there's probably tales about ghosts out over the sea and those that have drowned that come to the surface in a storm or something. And maybe, and whatever it was, they thought it was a ghost. And we've been, what we can relate to maybe having irrational thoughts in times of fears like that. And so they cried out, it's a ghost! And they were troubled. But immediately he talked to them and he said to them, be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. Look at those three expressions. He starts off positive. Be of good cheer. That word can mean be of good courage. And he said, it is I. Be not afraid. Positive, be of good cheer. Negative, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. But the central words, it is I. What a comfort that must have been to them. Now this reminds me of a little World War II story I read about one of these old bombers went out over Germany, and these were the squadron, you know, and they got pretty shot up. And the other bombers dropped their bombs and headed back to England, and here they are, they're left alone, and they're limping, and they know, boy, we're like sitting ducks up here. And they look up, and here come the fighters to take them down, and they're getting ready to try to shoot their way through that. And as those fighters approach, one of those planes tips its wing, and they see that it's the British Spitfires that came back to escort them home. Don't be afraid. They thought it was a ghost. Be of good cheer. It is I. That's the central message. Be not afraid. And he went to them in the ship and the wind ceased. How did he walk on the waves like that? And in my mind, I think of how it must have been a calm right about Jesus when he's walking. Everything's boisterous and the waves are turning, but where Jesus is, there's a calm. And he brings that calm to the boat, and he can step into the boat, and then there's a calm over all the surface of the sea. But in the apostles' hearts, they were still racing. They were sore amazed in themselves, beyond measure, for they considered not the miracle of the load, for their heart was hardened. And this isn't being complimentary to them when they tell this story this way, that they were so amazed. They should have already known better than this. They'd already seen Jesus still a storm on the sea before, and they had just seen him feed these 5,000 with a few loaves and fishes. And no doubt it would be amazing to see Jesus come walking across the sea in the midst of a storm, but not this amazing. They should have already been able to accept something like this. But they were amazed beyond measure and wondered. They were having a hard time understanding the significance of all these miracles and what Jesus could do. And they should have understood that by now. They understood in Gennesaret. This is a place where Jesus had not been very much, but they passed over and came to the land of the Gennesaret and drew on shore. And when they saw him, they knew who it was. They knew this was Jesus. Look how they reacted. They ran through the whole region round about and began to carry about in beds those that were sick when they heard he was there, where they heard he was. And whithersoever he entered into villages or cities or country, they laid the sick in the streets and besought him that he might touch them as it were but the border of his garment. And as many as were touched were made whole. They believed. And some of them may have seen some of the miracles Jesus did, but most of these people had heard and believed. Jesus can do anything. If he did these things, we heard what he has done. If he can do that, he can do anything. And they came to him. And the apostles that had seen these things, they should have been able to believe like that. But then here's where I want to bring this lesson home. We've heard. Should this so amaze us? And if they were chastised for their lack of faith, now that we've got all this documentation of what Jesus has done and know all the wonders and even his own resurrection from the dead, should we be amazed? From based on what they'd heard, they believed. And based on what we've heard, we should believe. And like they came to him for their physical ailments, we can come to him with our spiritual problems, and he can heal. And so there's our lesson for the morning. I want you to read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and when you do, always remember, these things are written that we might believe. And look at the evidence that is there. They're never told as wild tales. They're told as though these things really happen, and the details help confirm what happened. And so we need to come to Jesus. Jesus tells us how we approach him. We turn from our sins when we come to him. We confess our faith with our mouth, and we're baptized into Christ. And we come up out of that water a new creature and spend the rest of our lives living for him. Do you believe? And if you do, then you need to respond while we sing the invitation song.